Hello everyone, I'm your host Kaustubh Pawar, and in this fourth session of GPAT online session series, we are going to see and learn about formulation and evaluation about injections, which is a part of pharmaceutics. It's one of the most important subject and a topic from GPAT perspective, because each year, as you saw in previous session also, there was one question from parenterals or injections, and also from an industrial point of view. In future, when you will work in the industry, nowadays industry is trying to make formulations in an injectable or a parenteral form because it's the most efficient dosage form. So that's why we are going to study about how to make parenterals, what are the formulation aspects and the excipients which goes into the injectable dosage form, as well as what are the evaluation parameters of the injections. And then we are going to see the packaging material, mostly the glass packaging material, as it is mostly widely used packaging material for parenterals. So let's start with this fourth session. So the first aspect of the parenteral or injectable is the vehicle, because to formulate any parenteral formulation, any injectable formulation, we need a vehicle in which our drug and other excipients will get solubilized and we will make the final formulation. So for vehicle, there are two aspects. First one is the aqueous vehicle. In aqueous vehicle, there are two types of vehicles. First is water for injection, and the second one is sterile water for injection. So these two comes under aqueous vehicles. And other than aqueous vehicle, we have non-aqueous vehicles too, for drugs which are hydrolytically degradable. So for those drugs, we use non-aqueous vehicles. So these are the various parameters, most important parameters with respect to water for injection and sterile water for injection from a GPAT perspective, as well as for your future when you will work in R&D, F&D. So first point and the most important point is of sterility. There is a key difference between water for injection and sterile water for injection with respect to sterility. So when you will see, as I have mentioned, water for injections are pyrogen free but not sterile. Please remember and make a note, water for injections are not sterile, whereas on the other aspect, sterile water for injections are sterile as well as pyrogen free. So this is the key difference between water for injection and sterile water for injection. Most of the time students get confused whether water for injection is sterile or not. So that's why please keep it in mind that water for injections are not sterile. Aqueous vehicle, we have sterile water for injections. Now why it is so? Because when as in the second point, you can see the preparation method. Water for injections are prepared by the distillation, reverse osmosis, ultrafiltration or heating. So when we process the potable water through distillation or reverse osmosis, there might be chances that the microorganism might be present in a dead form in the final vehicle. And that's why we cannot say that it will be sterile. So that's why we make it pyrogen free by depyrogenation method. But then also there might be chances that there might be some dead microorganisms present in the water for injection vehicle. Therefore, it is said as not sterile. Whereas on the other case, to prepare sterile water for injection, we process the water for injection by thermal sterilization and we make it sterile, in which there is no single microorganism present. It is absolutely sterile. So this is the reason why water for injection is not sterile, because there might be chances that dead microorganisms might be present after the process. And sterile water for injection is absolutely sterile, and both the vehicles are pyrogen free. Then the next point is of total solid content. So there is a limit according to pharmacopoeias. The water for injection, the total solid content should be not more than 10 ppm. Whereas for sterile water for injection, the limit is of 40 ppm. So the total solid content should not be more than 40 ppm. Then similarly, there is ionic contaminant. So ionic contaminants for water for injection should be not more than 0.1 ppm. So please note down all these important parameters for your GPAT perspective, because there might be questions. And I think so in GPAT 2012 or 11, there was question with respect to this part, that is how much total solid content is present in sterile water for injection, and the correct answer was not more than 40 ppm. So these are few important parameters. Then the total organic carbon. So total organic carbon content in water for injection is not more than 500 ppm. So if you make this like this chart, it will be very easy to remember. Then moving to next parameter is that bacterial count and endotoxin count. These are two various very important parameters with respect to parenterals, because water for injection, there might be bacterial count about 10 CFU per ml. CFU is none other than colony forming unit, is called as CFU. So bacterial count for water for injection can be 10 CFU per ml, but in sterile water for injection, the bacterial count be zero because it is sterile. And if it is a container, if it is more than 30 ml, that is large volume parenterals are there, then we can add some bacteriostatic agents. So contain bacteriostatic agents for more than 30 ml of container. So for large volume of parenterals, we can add bacteriostatic agents to prevent bacterial growth. So then the next point is of endotoxin count. So for endotoxin count, the water for injection limit is 0.25 EU per ml. EU means endotoxin unit is endotoxin. And sterile water for injection, there should be no endotoxin limit. Zero endotoxin, zero bacterial count. Then the next is residue on evaporation. So when we evaporate our vehicle, how much residue is left behind? It's counted. And the limit for water for injection is less than 1 mg per ml, that is 0.001%, whereas for sterile water for injection, the limit is less than 4 mg. For 10 ml container and for more than 10 ml containers, the limit decreases to 3 mg, that is 0.003%. So this is the limit for residue on evaporation. Please remember, for water for injection, less than 1 mg, and for sterile water for injection, there are two different parameters. For 10 ml container, less than 4 mg, for more than 10 ml, less than or equal to 3 mg. Bacterial count for water for injection, 10 CFU per ml, endotoxin 0.25 EU per ml, and no bacterial count, no endotoxin count in sterile water for injection. Then the conductivity is also checked for any vehicle. So for water for injection, it should be not more than 1 micromole, and pH for both should be between the range of 5 to 7. It is an ideal pH. Then last two parameters is the storage condition for water for injection, because there might be chances that pyrogen can regrow in water for injection. So therefore, it's essential to store water for injection in this storage conditions only to prevent pyrogen growth, and these are 5 degrees Celsius or 60 to 80 degrees Celsius. So when we store water for injection at 5 degrees Celsius and 60 to 80 degrees Celsius, the pyrogen growth can be prevented, and thus it can be maintained for 24 hours, and we can use further. So this is the basic storage condition, and most important, when you will work in industry, you should know these parameters. And the last point is the use. What is exactly the use of water for injection, and what sterile water for injection, also called as SWFI, is used for? Water for injection is used for the formulations that are terminally sterilized, because water for injection might contain dead microorganisms. They are not sterile, and therefore, when we formulate a formulation which is terminally sterilized at the end, after formulation, after that, when we sterilize it by membrane filtration or by thermal sterilization, at that time we can use water for injection. But there are few formulations which are not intended or which are not terminally sterilized. For those formulations, we have to use sterile water for injection because it is absolutely sterile. So what are such formulations? So such formulations are reconstitution of sterile powder. So when we formulate a sterile powder, and when it is intended for administration, we reconstitute it. So those sterile powder should be reconstituted with sterile water for injection and not with the water for injection. So always remember, reconstitution of sterile powder is done with SWFI, sterile water for injection, and the formulations which are not terminally sterilized. So these are the most important parameters and the clear-cut differentiation between water for injection and sterile water for injection. So these were the aqueous vehicles. So apart from the aqueous vehicle, as I already mentioned, there are few non-aqueous vehicles also which we can use to formulate injections, and these are used for the drugs. They are used for the drugs which are hydrolytically degradable. Therefore, we use non-aqueous vehicles. So in this, there are different vehicles like fixed vegetable oils can be used, ethanol in a limited amount, which is mentioned as per pharmacopoeia permitted amount, then glycerol or propylene glycol or PEG. So these are a few non-aqueous vehicles which we can use for formulating an injection. There is an exception. We cannot use mineral oils because they are not permitted to be used and they are harmful when we use through injection. So mineral oils cannot be used. Please remember, there is exception. Mineral oils cannot be used as a vehicle for formulation of injection. So based upon this simple concept, there was question in GPAT 2014. The oil used in a parenteral product cannot contain, and as I have highlighted correctly, the correct answer is paraffin oil because it is a mineral oil. And as mineral oil cannot be used in parenteral product. So such simple questions are asked in GPAT. Moving to next point is the solubilizing agent. So the first important excipient or the vehicle which we saw was the vehicles, aqueous, non-aqueous vehicles. The second formulation aspect is the solubilizing agent, because we have to solubilize the drug in our formulation. If it is an emulsion, we require emulsifying agent. If it is a suspension, we require suspending agents. So which solubilizing agents we can use? So the most important and most widely used solubilizing agent is a non-ionic surfactant called as lecithin, because lecithin is biocompatible, as well as the lecithin is present in our lungs, one form of a lecithin, and that's why lecithin is most suitable to be used in formulating an injection. It is used to solubilize vitamins, hormones, volatile oils and many more drugs. So this is the non-ionic surfactant which we use in injectable formulation. The second solubilizing agent which nowadays widely being used is cyclodextrin. As cyclodextrin is an oligosaccharide molecule, it is a cyclic formulation of cyclic structure of oligosaccharide molecule which have internal hydrophilic, which have a cavity of hydrophilic and hydrophobic moieties. Both can be entrapped in the cyclodextrin. So it forms inclusion complex in the with the drug, and thus it encapsulates both. It can entrap both hydrophilic as well as hydrophobic moieties. There are three different types of cyclodextrin which are present. First one is alpha, second one is gamma, and third one is beta. So as I have mentioned, this is important point. Alpha and gamma cyclodextrin can be used for parenteral products, but beta cyclodextrin is not used in parenteral products as it may cause severe kidney damage. And that's why there might be question on cyclodextrin, like which cyclodextrin can be used for parenteral products. So the correct answer will be alpha and gamma cyclodextrin and not the beta one, because beta causes kidney damage. So in GPAT 2017, there was one question related to cyclodextrin only. That is number of glucopyranose unit. As I have mentioned, it is made up of oligosaccharide, cyclic oligosaccharide molecules, and those oligosaccharide molecules contain glucopyranose units in this. So the question was number of glucopyranose units in structure of alpha cyclodextrin are. So there are different number of glucopyranose units present in three different cyclodextrin molecules. So the correct answer is 6. So 6 glucopyranose units are present in alpha cyclodextrin, 7 glucopyranose units are present in beta cyclodextrin, and 8 glucopyranose units are present in gamma cyclodextrin. So always remember these three points. Alpha contains 6 glucopyranose units, beta contains 7, and gamma contains 8. So this was about solubilizing agents. Now the third and the most important parameter of a formulation is buffer, because as injection or any parenteral formulation is directly injected in our blood circulation, it should match with the pH of our blood. It should be within the tolerable range. And that's why it's essential to maintain the pH range. And therefore, we add buffers in it. So there are different types of buffer which we can use. And we add buffer, as we all know, ideal pH of injection should be 7.4, because the pH of blood is in the range of 7.2 to 7.4. And therefore, we have to maintain ideal pH of injection within this range of 7.4. But it's very difficult to maintain this pH. And therefore, generally, it is widely accepted that we can adjust the pH between 4 to 9. Because pinpointing the pH at 7.4 is quite difficult in any formulation. Therefore, the buffers can be added to maintain the pH between the range of 4 to 9. And there is a blood tolerable pH. So how much blood can tolerate the pH is the range is 3 to 10.5. And so therefore, rather than keeping 3 to 10.5, we adjust the pH between 4 to 9. And we keep a buffer of 1 unit. So the blood tolerable pH range is 3 to 10.5. So generally, pH of any formulation is adjusted between 4 to 9. And ideally, it will be 7.4. So this is the most important parameter from your formulation aspect, or when you will work in R&D, F&D, or when you will do project in your master's. If you want to formulate an injection and you will add a buffer, choose the buffer which have pKa within the desired pH, plus or minus range of desired pH. So the pKa of the buffer should be within plus or minus range of desired pH. So if you want to adjust your pH at suppose 6, then the pKa of your buffer should be plus or minus in a 1% of the range, either 5 or either 7. So if it is then it will be best suited buffer. It will be most ideal buffer to use for your formulation. And why it is so? Because the maximum buffer capacity is the maximum buffer capacity of buffer is when pH or when pKa of your buffer is equal to pH. So as you can, I will mention here maximum buffer capacity of any buffer is when pKa of that buffer is equal to pH of you want to adjust. So then you will get the maximum buffer capacity. Therefore, if you will get a buffer having pKa plus or minus range of desired pH, it will be most ideal buffer. So the most commonly used buffer are acetate, citrates, phosphates, glutamates, and bicarbonates. So these are most commonly used buffers. There is a key point from your GPAT and competitive exam perspective in which dosage forms or route of administration buffers are not used. So buffers are not used in intracardiac and intraocular parenteral dosage form. Please remember this. In the rest of other dosage forms, parenteral dosage forms, buffers can be used, but in intracardiac and intraocular, buffers cannot be used. So this was the three most important parameters with respect to injectable formulation. Now we will see the packaging of packaging materials. And the most important packaging material in this is the glass packaging material from pharmaceutics. So as we all know, glass is made up of soda lime. So the basic glass is a soda lime glass, which have a potential to leach alkali in our content, in our formulation, and therefore it can change the pH and thus affect the solubility and stability of drugs. And therefore we have to treat this glass with silicon or moist sulfur dioxide at about 500 degrees Celsius to minimize the leaching, and thus we will get our ideal glass for packaging any parenteral formulation or for any other purpose. So just to revise, as we all know, glass are made up of soda lime glass, and as it is an alkali, it has potential to leach the alkali material, the soda material, alkali material in our content. And when it will leach the alkali material from the glass in our content, it will obviously change the pH of the formulation. And once when it will change the pH, it will affect the solubility and stability of drug. And thus, there might be chances that either our drug will degrade or its efficacy will be lost. and therefore it's our duty to make our glass more hydrolytic resistant, and therefore we treat the glass with either silicon or with moist sulfur dioxide at about 500 degrees Celsius, and thus it will reduce the leaching of alkali material, and thus we will get the different types of glass. So this is the basic concept of how the glass are classified between different types. So based upon this concept only, our Indian pharmacopoeia classifies the glass in three types based on the amount of alkali released into the content. And the USP classifies in four types. In USP, they add a fourth type, which is a non-parenteral glass, type 4. So let's see in detail different types of glass. So type 1 glass, which is also called as a borosilicate glass because it is a soda lime glass, which is it is a borosilicate made up of glass, also called as a neutral glass, and it is most highly hydrolytic resistant, and it has lowest thermal expansion. As it is made up of borosilicate material, it is highly hydrolytic resistant, and therefore it is intended and it is allowed to be used for packaging of parenterals. So any parenteral ampoule or vial is made up of type 1 glass, also called as borosilicate glass, because it is most highly hydrolytic resistance. It means that there will be negligible leaching of the alkali, and it is best suited for alkaline products. So this is the significance and the use of type 1 glass. Now moving to type 2 glass, the alkali leaching increases as compared to type 1, because in type 2 glass they are made up of soda lime silica glass, which are also called as treated glass, because this soda lime silica glass are treated with sulfur dioxide gas to de-alkalize the surface and thus prevent the leakage and provide hydrolytic resistance. So this is the significance and the concept of type 2. So type 2 glass are soda lime silica glass, also called as treated soda lime glass, because the inner surface of the glass is treated with sulfur dioxide gas to de-alkalize it and thus to provide hydrolytic resistance. So the important point in this is which materials can be packed in this glass. So acidic, basic and neutral products can be packed in the type 2 glass, whereas large volume parenterals, dry sterile powders can be also packed in type 2 glass. So this is important. Acidic, basic, neutral products can be packed in type 2 glass, as well as large volume parenterals and dry sterile powders. Then the third type is the regular soda lime silica glass. It is a non-treated glass. Soda lime silica glass treated is type 2, and non-treated, which is also called as regular soda lime silica glass, is type 3, and it is more leachable. It more leaches the oxides as well as alkali as compared to type 2. And for what it is used? It is used for non-aqueous or oleaginous products, for or powders for oral and topical use. So these are used for oral and topical use only, type 3 glass. And the last one, type 4 glass, which is also called as a non-parenteral glass because it is not intended, it is not allowed to be used for parenterals. So it is a non-parenteral glass because it is a general purpose soda lime silica glass, and it has very low hydrolytic resistance, that is, it has maximum leaching because it is not treated and it is general purpose soda lime silica glass. So therefore it can be used for liquids, semi-solids or solid dosage forms, but not for parenterals. So this is the brief general description and differentiation between different types of glass, type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4, and is the most important point from your GPAT perspective, because they try to ask questions on glass packaging. So let's see few questions which were asked in GPAT 2020. So there were two questions asked in GPAT 2020 from packaging. So the first question was, type 2 glass containers are, and as I have correctly mentioned, they are suitable for most acidic and neutral aqueous preparations, because as you saw in this previous slide, I have mentioned its use. Acidic and basic neutral products, acidic, basic and neutral products can be packed in type 2, and therefore type 2 glass containers are best suited for most acidic and neutral aqueous preparations. For alkaline solutions, it will be type 1 glass. Most inert glass and shows high hydrolytic resistance will be type 1. this is type 2 and not suitable for non-aqueous preparation, obviously type 4 glass. So likewise, if you remember its name, its significance, and if it's used, it's sufficient. Then the GPAT 2020 next question on the packaging was, the general purpose soda lime silica glass is not suitable material for fabricating the container for, and as I have correctly mentioned, it is parenterals. So for as general purpose soda lime silica glass is none other than type 4 glass, and it is not suited for parenteral formulation. So such simple questions are asked. If you know the concept, if your concept is clear, then it is very easy to solve these questions. Then moving to the last point, which is evaluation of parameters. So initially we saw formulation, different vehicles, solubilizing agents and buffers, then we saw glass packaging materials. Now we will see evaluation parameters. So in evaluation parameters, we have four important tests. First one is leaker test or leaking test, which is used to study the integrity of ampoules, whether ampoules have crack or holes or there is any defect in ampoules. It is checked in a leaker test. So ampoules are basically filled with methylene blue indicator of color, and they are placed in vacuum chamber. So when we apply the pressure, if there are any leakage, the methylene blue indicator or the solution will come out, and thus we can know whether there are any leakages, any cracks in the ampoules. Now the second test is of clarity test. So clarity tests are basically used to study the particle limits. So as I mentioned in second session of GPAT, there are various limits based upon the evaluation technique. So there are different techniques to study the clarity test. First one is visual inspection, which is generally used by looking the formulation across the black background or any white background. So that is visual inspection, or else by microscopic technique, or else by light obstruction technique based upon scattering principle. The clarity test can be performed to measure the particles. So this was the second, because particles, if there are particles beyond a certain limit and beyond a certain diameter, it can cause embolism and suddenly death. So therefore it is very important to limit and to know the what is the particle range and what is the particle size. Now the third and the most important evaluation parameter is of pyrogen test, also called as bacterial endotoxin test. So what is the another name for pyrogen or bacterial endotoxin test is limeless amebiocyte lysate test, also called as LAL test. Now what's the principle of this LAL test? So basically, first of all, it is an in vitro test. It is performed outside the body, therefore it is an in vitro test. So when a formulation contains pyrogen or endotoxins, then it forms gel. It undergoes gelling with the lysate of amebiocyte of limulus polyphemus. So limulus polyphemus is another word for horseshoe crab. So what's the procedure for pyrogen test or LAL test? We have a kit. In that kit, we have this lysate of amebiocyte of limulus polyphemus. In that lysate, we add our formulation. And if that formulation contains pyrogens or endotoxins, it will form gel within 60 minutes at 37 degrees Celsius. So we keep that formulation, formulation injected in the lysate for 60 minutes. And if that thing undergoes gelling within 60 minutes at 37 degrees Celsius, we can say that our formulation contains pyrogen. And if it doesn't, then our formulation is pyrogen free. So this is most widely used test for determining the pyrogen or endotoxin limit, which is limulus amebiocyte lysate test. So after that, before discovering this amebiocyte, there was test to determine the pyrogen endotoxin. The test was performed on rabbits. So it was called as a rabbit test. And it was an in vivo test in which our formulation were injected into the rabbits. And if our formulation contained pyrogen or endotoxin, it would raise the temperature of rabbits by 0.3 degrees Celsius. And thus we would know that whether our formulation contains pyrogen or not. But nowadays it has been banned. And in place of that, we are referring this limulus amebiocyte lysate test. for determining the pyrogens. So these were the two tests for pyrogen. One was in vitro, one was in vivo. And the fourth and most important test is sterility test, because it's essential to know whether our formulation is sterile or not. So there are two methods, method A and method B. Method A is called as membrane filtration method, and method B is called as direct inoculation method. In membrane filtration method, we take a membrane, we filter our parenteral formulation, and that membrane is incubated. And after incubation, if there is a growth on that membrane, we will know whether our formulation is sterile or not. And in direct inoculation method, we directly inoculate our formulation in the media and we keep it for incubation. And when after certain period, if there is a growth in the microorganism, then we can say it is not sterile. So these are the basic principles of membrane filtration method and direct inoculation method. So there are three different medias which we can use based upon the bacteria which we want to analyze. So for aerobic bacteria, generally nutrient broth can be used as a media for direct inoculation method for growth. Then if our purpose is to check whether there's aerobic as well as anaerobic bacteria, then we can use fluid thioglycolate medium. And generally bacteria are incubated at 32.5 degrees Celsius. Always remember, incubation temperature of bacteria is 32.5 degrees Celsius, whereas of fungi, incubation time is 22.5 degrees Celsius. And when we want to analyze the fungi or aerobic bacteria, we can use soybean casein digest media. So for fungi, it is soybean casein digest media at 22.5 degrees Celsius. For anaerobic bacteria, we can use fluid thioglycolate media at 32.5 degrees Celsius incubation temperature. And if it is only aerobic bacteria general purpose, then we can use nutrient broth also. These are four important parenteral evaluation parameters which we have to pass and our formulation have to comply. So based upon this, in GPAD 2018 and 15, there were two questions asked on the same basic concept, and the first one was the vials and bottles are regularly not subjected in following test, and the correct answer is leakage test. Now please try to understand how the question was asked and how the options are given. Now in here they have mentioned vials and bottles, so they are referring here about parenteral product, about injectable product. So here they are not referring to merely vials and bottles, but they are referring to injectable products which are not regularly subjected to the following test. And so therefore leakage test is not essential to be daily analyzed, but sterility, clarity and pyrogen test are essential for each and every single batch. So please remember, like this tricky question can be asked in GPAT. Now in GPAT 2015, the question was bacterial endotoxins are mainly detected by, and it is a clear cut answer. It is LAL test, Lysate, Limulus Amebiosite Lysate test. So it was a simple question. So these were the two questions based on the parenteral formulation from previous years. So this was the today's session. I hope you liked this session. So we will just brief through what today we learned. So in the first slide, as I mentioned, we are going to see about formulation of injections, evaluation of injections and packing materials, all from the pharmaceutics. So in formulation for injection, we saw vehicles, clear differentiation between water for injection and sterile water for injection. Please remember the key point is water for injections are pyrogen free, but not sterile, whereas sterile water for injections are pyrogen free and sterile. Then we saw different parameters and its limits for both. Then we saw the storage condition and the use of WFI and SWFI. Then we studied and we learned about non-aqueous vehicles, for what they are used and what is the exception in non-aqueous vehicle. We solved one question. Then we moved to solubilizing agent. Which solubilizing agent can be used for formulation of an injection? There are two different, lecithin, cyclodextrin. We solved one question on that. Then we saw buffers, why buffers are useful and what should be the ideal buffer you should use. Then we saw glass packaging material, the concept of glass and why they are treated. Then different types of glass, type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4 glass, their significance and use and what they are called. Then we solved previous year question paper. Actually, this is this year only, CPAT 2020, based on parenteral packaging. Then we saw evaluation of parenterals, four important tests, leaker, clarity, pyrogen, and sterility test. And we saw two questions on the evaluation of parenterals. I hope you all liked this session. And if you liked, please subscribe and follow my Instagram page as well as my YouTube channel to get daily updates about GPAT, pharmacy, and medicines. Thank you.